Of all the great campaigns in the long annals of war, there are few which linger much in the consciousness of the public at large. But the poignant images of hardship and despair which we associate with the wreck of a great army will always ensure that the mere mention of the date of Napoleon's great Russian adventure still strikes a chord with even the least interested layman. That year was 1812, the setting for what was to become one of the most spectacular military disasters in the history of warfare, the virtual destruction of the largest military machine the world had yet seen. The seeds of Napoleon's great adventure had been sown in the uneasy treaty concluded between Prussia, Russia and France in July 1807. Peace had been reached after 2 years of struggle between France and the combined armies of Austria, Prussia and Russia, during which Napoleon had gained some of his most famous victories in a career of famous victories. Names which still ring down the corridors of fame: Austerlitz, Jena, Auerstadt, Eylau and Ulm. With the signing of the treaty, the emperor was finally able to coerce the Russians into joining his continental system along with the equally reluctant Prussians. The continental system was designed to stimulate trade within Europe and to carry on war with England by economic means. England, as Napoleon's implacable foe, was to be excluded from all trade within continental Europe. Not surprisingly, the Russian Tsar Alexander I was a less than willing partner in a system which soon proved economically ruinous for many influential merchants and which drew him into an unlooked-for war with Great Britain, leading to a series of major devaluations of the ruble.
Well, Napoleon was very distressed by the way in which Alexander, Tsar of all the Russias, had left the continental system. This was the idea, of course, of starving Britain into a more complacent frame of mind by removing all our trade from the continent. And originally at Tilsit, Alexander had signed for this and agreed to do it. But because of the pressure of his court nobility, who were finding a lot of their profits from their forests, for example, were disappearing, the Tsar had allowed more and more exceptions. And Napoleon was very much determined to bring him back, because if Tsar Alexander would not conform, then nobody else would conform, as he was the biggest ruler after Napoleon in Europe.
The award of the empty Swedish throne to Marshal Bernadotte, whom the Russians then saw as a potential enemy, coupled with French intrigues in Persia, the Balkans and Turkey, and the diplomatic insult which resulted from Napoleon's marrying Marie-Louise of Austria while negotiations were still underway with Russia, all contributed to the increasing tension between the two countries and finally the declaration of war. French forces crossed the river Niemen into Russia in June 1812, and the long-expected war was finally begun. In the ranks of Napoleon's guard marched the 27-year-old Sergeant Burgoyne in the Regiment of Fusilier Grenadiers. He was later to produce a diary record of the campaign, which has come to be seen as a magnificent testament to the triumph of human spirit in adversity. In June, these trials were still comparatively far off. Initially, everything went well for the French, and spirits were high. It was in the month of March 1812, while we were engaged against the English army commanded by Wellington at Almeida in Portugal, that we received orders to march for Russia. We crossed Spain, each day being marked by an engagement, sometimes by two, and in this way reached Bayonne, the first town over the frontier in France. On leaving this place, we travelled by the stage as far as Paris. where we expected to stay and rest. But after a halt of just 48 hours, the Emperor reviewed us and, deciding that we were not in need of rest, marched us all along the boulevards. We found several hundred coaches and other vehicles waiting for us. We halted and were ordered to mount four into every carriage. And crack, we were off to Meaux. From there onwards to the Rhine in wagons, traveling day and night. We passed over the Niemen by our pontoons and entered Lithuania, the first province in Russia. In order to achieve the rapid subjugation of the Russians, Napoleon had assembled what was then the largest and most powerful military force in history. For this great enterprise, more than 650,000 men were assembled from every nation then under the sway of the French Empire.
In 1812, Napoleon was not underprepared for the kind of campaign he expected to fight. He believed that the massing of over 500,000 men on the Tsar's frontiers would be enough in itself to force his erstwhile friend of Treaty of Tilsit in 1807 back into his alliance and into the continental system. But if he did have to fight, Napoleon did not anticipate going beyond 50 miles into Russian Poland, because he felt that he would be able to force a decisive battle early in the campaign, which was always his objective. But he certainly was not prepared for a winter campaign, or one which stretched him all the way to Moscow.
With 16 years of seemingly invincible success as a general behind him, Napoleon exercised his usual outstanding control over the necessary logistics for such a huge undertaking. He also had a clear plan for the whole campaign, which demonstrated the consummate mastery of grand strategy on which he had built a historic career. The Emperor organized his mass of manpower into three main lines. In the first wave, the 445,000 troops who constituted the group of three armies with which Napoleon would conduct his campaign. Next came 165,000 men in a reserve line intended primarily to reinforce the first line and act as replacements where necessary. Finally, he placed a strategic reserve of 60,000 men in eastern Prussia and Poland. By virtue of his excellent advance intelligence, Napoleon was well aware of the dispositions of the various Russian armies facing him. As the focus for the campaign, he initially chose the extended army of Barclay de Tolly, a force of some 127,000 men spread over a vast front of 250 miles. In a repeat of the strategy which had often won him victory against superior odds, Napoleon planned to split de Tolly's force into two halves. By a fast-paced advance, then by process of rapid encirclement, he hoped to defeat each half of the Russian army in detail by concentrating a huge local superiority against each half in turn. In a dispatch to Davout, Napoleon summed up his strategy with the words, "The aim of all my moves will be to concentrate 400,000 men at a single point."
In such a vast project as the campaign of 1812, Napoleon, of course, just had to rely upon key subordinates. And where the Central Army Group was concerned, after himself, that meant Prince Eugène Beauharnais, who was his stepson, and also, of course, Prince Jerome Bonaparte, who was his kid brother and King of Westphalia. Both of those two gentlemen, frankly, let him down. Prince Eugène Beauharnais failed to pin Bagration's army and keep it out of the way of the campaign, as he was intended to do. The main reason being, of course, he was not used to operating with a large apparatus of convoys stretching out behind him. As for Jerome Bonaparte, he proved so totally inept that he had to be relieved of command on the 10th day of the campaign and sent back to Germany in semi-disgrace.
As we have seen, in order to achieve these objectives, Napoleon had at his immediate disposal some 450,000 troops. These 450,000 troops were composed of 80,000 cavalry and 370,000 infantry and gunners, supported by some 1,400 cannon. Facing this formidable opponent, the Russians were able to immediately draw upon three main field armies, totaling some 220,000 men. The first of these was the First Army of the West, under de Tolly, fielding 127,000 troops. the Second Army of 48,000 under the command of General Bagration, and the Third Army of the West, fielding 43,000 troops under General Tormasov. The Russians could therefore muster 40,000 cavalry, 180,000 infantry, and around 800 cannon. So what of the fighting men who formed these armies? Understandably, the quality of the troops who fought under Napoleon had declined since his great triumphs of 1807. The steady war of attrition in the peninsula between France, Spain, and Britain, known as Napoleon's Spanish ulcer, had slowly deprived the emperor of thousands of his best-trained and battle-hardened troops. At the time of the Russian invasion, 200,000 of his finest troops had to remain stationed in Spain. The young conscripts who replaced these veterans had so far spent most of their time in garrison and knew little of the real horrors of pitched battle. Additionally, Napoleon had to draw upon his allies in greater numbers than ever before. Consequently, the French Grande Armée of 1812 was only half French. The other half was composed of 190,000 Germans, Austrians, Swiss, and Prussians, 90,000 Poles, 20,000 Italians, and a collection of highly reluctant Spanish and Portuguese. From the Russian side, the Tsar knew he could draw upon the traditional Russian stoicism which caused his troops to endure the greatest hardships and risks with a kind of resigned fatalism which seemed to make them almost oblivious to even the most extreme dangers. Additionally, rigorous and violent discipline was imposed upon them by uncaring officers, which would have broken the spirit of almost any other nation. The French cavalryman Marbot wrote of his Russian opponent, "Although our soldiers fired on them at 20 paces, they continued to march past without reply. The streets were filled with the dying and wounded, but not a groan was heard, for it was forbidden to them." The rank and file of the Russian forces were drawn by conscription from the mass of peasant serfs who made up the bulk of the Russian population. As the serfs were effectively slaves who lived under the most miserable of conditions, they found it possible to endure even the harsh reality of life in the Russian army without complaint. By contrast to the admirable qualities of the men, the Russian officers were universally regarded as the worst in Europe. This criticism had been a recurrent theme since before the days of Peter the Great, who had sought to overcome the problem by importing Western European officers. To an extent, the worst excesses of bad Russian leadership had been eliminated in 1812. But still, one did not have to look too hard for examples of extreme incompetence. General Markov, for example, was removed from his command during the campaign when he proved incapable of distinguishing between roads and rivers on a map, while General Lacy, supreme commander in the Mediterranean theater, would actually produce a nightcap during councils of war, put it on, and go to sleep, leaving his subordinate generals to make the decisions. But if the individual skills of the Russian leaders were in some doubt, the strategy which they jointly pursued was without question the most effective policy they could possibly have chosen, had they been the cream of the world's military leaders. As Hitler was to discover to his great cost more than a century later, the sheer size of Russia and the appalling extremities of climate which she could hurl at an invader was to prove once again the most potent weapon in the Russian armory. As they had shown against the Swedes in the previous century, the Russians merely had to withdraw into the vast interior of their huge country, trading space for time, and inevitably their opponents would be worn down through sheer physical exhaustion. Their supply lines would also become vastly overextended and consequently very difficult to protect. The boiling summer sun on the limitless expanses of the never-ending Russian landscape was as much of an enemy as the merciless chill of a Russian winter, when deep snows lay uninterrupted for months, and the thermometer could often drop to a murderous minus 40 degrees below zero, and a man's breath would turn to icicles as it left his lips. Between 1941 and 1945, the problems of distance and climatic variations were eventually to prove insurmountable to Hitler's highly mechanized war machine. But for a horse-drawn army advancing on foot over a distance of more than 1,500 miles, they were to have catastrophic consequences over a few short months. To losses, each in turn from exhaustion, disease, heat stroke, exposure, and frostbite, was to be added the ever-present specter of starvation. The other element of the ruthless Russian policy of scorched earth withdrawal was to serve them so well once again against a foreign invader. Lost in a vast landscape with its apparently limitless steppes, the French were confronted with an elusive army who prepared to burn his own towns, villages, and crops in order to deny everything to Napoleon's army as it advanced. Whole herds of cattle would be slaughtered and left to rot if they could not be driven off. And every conceivable building or scrap of food in the path of the oncoming French army was destroyed. As the Russian armies gradually withdrew into the seemingly endless interior of Holy Mother Russia, the French were forced to pursue them further and further into a devastated and totally hostile landscape, completely devoid of shelter or food. Consequently, the French army shrank by probably 150,000 men, who deserted or perished from exhaustion, hunger or disease within 3 months of the start of the campaign. This, coupled with the need to protect his vastly overextended lines of supply, meant that a force which was 450,000 strong in June could muster only 150,000 men for the decisive battle of the campaign. Sergeant Burgoyne was already reduced to eating horse meat on the road to Moscow in the comparatively civilized days before the havoc of the winter retreat. I had just placed my men on a road leading to the château when a Polish servant, whose master was on the Emperor's staff, passed near us. He was leading a horse laden with baggage. The horse was worn out, sank down, and refused to get up again. So the servant took the baggage and went off. He had hardly left us when the men, who were ravenously hungry, killed the horse, and all that night we were busy eating it and cooking it for the next day. Soon afterwards, the Emperor himself passed on foot, accompanied by Murat, on their way to the high road. I made my sentries present arms. The Emperor stopped in front of us and near the horse, which filled up the road. He asked me if we were eating it. I replied, yes, we are. He smiled and said, patience. In 4 days we shall be at Moscow, where you will have rest and proper food. However good that horse may be. His prediction was fulfilled, for 4 days afterwards we arrived at that city. Many of the huge losses suffered by the French on their march into Russia, with hindsight, might be said to have been avoidable. But from the French point of view, the Russian campaign was preceded by the most painstaking preparations and incredible attention to detail, all personally supervised by the Emperor. Napoleon knew the problems he would be facing with bad roads, vast distances, and little prospect of finding supplies. He had made, by the standards of his time, some of the most accomplished preparations and supply arrangements ever produced for an army in any theater of war. But he was to be proved right when he observed, "We can hope for nothing from the countryside, and accordingly must take everything with us." To provide for his huge army, 26 special transport battalions were formed, which together provided some 10,000 wagons and carts pulled by 90,000 horses. These lumbering supply columns were accompanied by vast herds of cattle to supply meat on the hoof. Additionally, the Emperor had ordered that as the wagon loads of supplies were used up, the draft oxen were to be slaughtered to provide additional fresh meat for the troops. The popular view of the 1812 campaign seems to suggest that the destruction of the Grande Armée occurred almost independently of the Russian army and was simply an unlucky consequence of the effects of weather and distance operating on the unfortunate French, who, had they not been unprepared for winter, would easily have triumphed. By accepting this myth, we do a great disservice to a highly calculated and selfless Russian strategy, which was far from being the result of mere chance. The Russian grand strategy was always to draw the French deeper into Russia and further away from their supply bases, where hunger, cold, and disease would gnaw away at the bones of the great army. Tsar Alexander himself had publicly expounded this strategy. The Spaniards are frequently defeated by the French, but they are not beaten and have not surrendered. Moreover, they are not so far from Paris as we are. They have neither our climate nor our resources to help them. We shall take no risks. We have plenty of space. Our army is well organized. Your Frenchman is brave, but long sufferings and a hard climate wear down his resistance. Our climate, our winter, will fight on our side. The events of the following 4 months were to prove him all too correct. As we have seen, the French army was skillfully assembled and prepared to fight a war with Russia. But the crucial element of French planning was that these preparations were for a short war, which it was thought would be fought in Poland and Western Russia, lasting no more than 4 weeks. By simply retreating and drawing the French into the vast interior of Russia, the Tsar had commenced a strategy which would lead Napoleon along the fateful road to Moscow and his eventual destruction. Some of the seeds of Napoleon's eventual destruction lay in the change of heart which caused him to alter his initial plan, which was to attempt the swift encirclement and destruction of the larger Russian First Army under Anatoly. Learning that Bagration was on the move with the smaller Second Army of the West, Napoleon decided that instead he would first destroy this force. Crucially, however, he chose to delegate this vital mission to his subordinates, selecting Eugene's army of Italy for the task. As it happened all too often, his subordinates proved inferior to the task set for them by Napoleon. The appointment of Prince Eugene to the command of the army of Italy was really a political rather than a military decision, and the prince was soon able to demonstrate the folly of such a move by his complete inability to even maintain contact with Bagration. Consequently, precious days were lost in inactivity, while first Bagration, then d'Etoli's First Army, slipped inexorably eastwards, largely unmolested, towards a rendezvous near Smolensk. These few days of inactivity for the main army were followed by weeks of intense march and countermarch, as Napoleon himself attempted to execute a series of maneuvers to catch the elusive Russians, which his inferiors had allowed to slip away at a time when they could easily have been brought to battle. It was by now obvious that Napoleon had failed in his initial strategy of concentrating his force against a scattered enemy and bringing them to destruction in a series of pitched battles. Moreover, in the process, his army had become severely depleted by sickness, exhaustion, disease, and malnutrition. The route of his army in pursuit of the Russians as he drew nearer and nearer to Smolensk was marked by a trail of corpses rotting in the hot sun and adding to the enormous problems of disease in the ranks. Captain Röder, following in the wake of his army, noted, "We passed a good 3,000 dead horses lying by the roadside and even more rotting human corpses, which at this season of the year make a hideous stench." Had things been allowed to continue in this way, heat, dust, hunger, and exhaustion, it seemed, might have put paid to the Grand Army unaided. But it was now the Russians who were ready for a change of heart. The Russian population and their Tsar had grown increasingly unsettled with the constant policy of retreat, and pressure grew for a stand against the French. Napoleon would at last find an enemy which was increasingly ready to stop and fight. The two armies first closed in earnest at the inconclusive Battle of Smolensk on August the 17th. After the battle, the Russian withdrawal continued, until finally, at a village 60 miles from the gates of Moscow, they turned to fight what was to become the bloodiest pitched battle of the Napoleonic era, Borodino.
Barclay de Tolly had been Minister of War for almost 2 years when 1812 came to the climacteric moment, and he had certainly laid down a strategy which envisaged the Russians giving quite a bit of ground into Russia, and indeed a number of vast fortresses, such as that of Dunaburg, had been prepared about 100 miles inside the Russian frontier to be the key points for the Russian armies to fall back upon, because Barclay de Tolly was aware of the value of trading space for time. But that said, the Tsar had only been brought over to that frame of mind very unwillingly, and once Barclay de Tolly had retired beyond Smolensk, together with Bagration, who joined him for that battle, the Tsar became very alarmed. Where was this retreat going to end? Many very important estates were being overrun, and the noblemen at St. Petersburg were making a tremendous fuss about this. And so he decided to remove Barclay de Tolly from the top command, but appoint over his head the wily old veteran Kutuzov, who was a very much admired soldier in the Russian army.
Although he was approaching 70 years of age, Kutuzov had a brusque, brash manner which was intensely popular with the troops whom he had led at Austerlitz, even though he was also over-fond of alcohol and young women. With an increasingly patriotic mood of dogged determination building in the country behind him, Kutuzov was to prove an inspired choice. He was welcomed with open arms by the armies he had commanded in 1807. Russian morale soared. On the other hand, by 1812, Napoleon was beginning to suffer increasingly from ill health, which constantly hampered his abilities as a general. As on the day of one of his other most crucial battles, that of Waterloo, he was not at his best at Borodino. Consequently, his battle plan was uninspired. Essentially, Napoleon's plan was nothing more than a series of hammer blows to be delivered frontally against the Russian lines in the hope that they would crack. From the Russian point of view, the necessity to dig in and doggedly defend Moscow meant that their own response was equally uninspired, and as such was simply to resist the French attacks and hold ground at all costs. On the 6th of September, the Russian 1st and 2nd armies, now united, had taken up positions south of the River Moscow in the west of the city in order to deny the French any further advance on Russia's religious capital. The task in hand was clear to all ranks in the army, and the defensive nature of the coming struggle was underlined by the construction of a huge redoubt, a temporary earth fort, which housed 20 heavy cannon and formed a focal point for Russian resistance. The bitter struggle for possession of this grand redoubt has become a symbol of the bloody fighting which characterized the battle. The grand redoubt was barely finished in time when at 6 a.m. the massed French guns opened fire and the Grande Armée rolled forward to attack. Through the long day, these two sides doggedly attacked and counterattacked with selfless courage, unparalleled in the history of the Napoleonic era.
The Battle of Borodino was without any doubt the most horrendous single day's fighting in history. Now, Burgoyne speaks about there being 60,000 casualties. In fact, he was in no position to know, as just a sergeant commentator. The casualties were much nearer, something like 75,000 men on that battlefield, Russians included, as well as the Frenchmen. Now that means, bringing in a modern parallel, a jumbo jet full of passengers crashing into an area 5 miles square every 5 minutes for 8 hours without a single survivor.
Gradually, the Russians were pushed back, and by mid-morning, the Grand Redoubt was captured by the French, but at an enormous cost to both sides. Slowly giving ground, the Russian fighting spirit refused to crack, despite the loss of this important symbol of their struggle and the death of the popular General Bagration. And more French forces had to be thrown forward in the attack on the Russian defenders. Driven from their advanced positions, the Russian infantry were forced to form a square to beat back French cavalry attacks. But still, their spirit and will to resist held. Nonetheless, as that desperate day wore on, the Russians twice looked as if they might be beaten by one last mighty effort. However, Napoleon was by now reduced to his very last reserves, the Imperial Guard, his personal army of 50,000 battle-hardened veterans. Despite the desperate pleas of Murat, Davout, and Ney, Napoleon refused to commit the Guard, and the opportunity to decisively defeat the Russians was lost. With 1,200 miles between his home bases and his present position, the decision not to risk his last fit reserve of manpower was probably the correct one under the circumstances. However, his failure to eliminate the Russian army was to prove fatal. Sergeant Burgoyne was in one of Napoleon's elite guard regiments. So, with the rest of the Imperial Guard, he spent the day inactive on the battlefield. We got ready on the 6th for the great battle on the next day. Some cleaned muskets and other weapons, others made bandages for the wounded, some made their wills, and others, again, sang or slept in perfect indifference. The whole of the Imperial Guard received orders to appear in full uniform. At 5 o'clock on the morning of the next day, we were under arms. The Emperor passed near us while he reviewed the whole line. He had already been mounted for more than half an hour. The battle began at 7 o'clock. I cannot describe it in detail, but the whole army was overjoyed to hear the roar of artillery. We felt certain that this time the Russians had not decamped and that we should come face to face with them. This, like all our great battles, was won by the artillery, which fired 120,000 rounds. The Russians lost at least 50,000, either killed or wounded. Our loss was 17,000 men. Each moment a message was sent to the Emperor, "Sire, such and such a general is killed or wounded," and his place had to be filled on the spot. This was how Colonel Annibert was made general. I remember it very well, for I was close to the Emperor at the time. His words were, "Colonel, I appoint you general. Lead the division which is front of the great redoubt, and take it." The general galloped off, with his adjutant major following him as his aide-de-camp. A quarter of an hour afterwards, the aide-de-camp returned and announced to the Emperor that the redoubt was taken, but that the new general was wounded. 8 days afterwards, he died, along with several others. I heard that the Russians lost 50 generals, either killed or wounded. While the fighting lasted, we were placed in reserve. Balls fell all amongst our ranks and round the Emperor. The battle ended with the day, and we remained on the field all night, and all the next day, the 8th.
Le 8. Passer cette journée à marcher sur le champ.
I spent that day in walking over the field, a sad and terrible spectacle. For the whole of that long day, the battle wore on with the Russians taking the bulk of the casualties. With typical disregard for the lives of the men, the Russian commanders still allowed many formations to spend the day standing stock still, exposed to French artillery fire. And in some cases, they lost as many as half of their manpower without moving from the spot or firing a shot. Late in the afternoon, many lives were saved by the simple order to sit down rather than stand in the face of the murderous fire. By evening, the exhausted armies simply stopped fighting by almost mutual consent. 60,000 casualties lay on the field, and the French had gained a mere half a mile or so of ground. Nonetheless, the superhuman effort of resistance and the appalling casualties which they had suffered caused the Russians to begin to withdraw under cover of darkness. The road to Moscow was finally open. If victory it was, the victory at Borodino was to prove a Pyrrhic success. Ironically, Napoleon now found himself the almost reluctant possessor of his enemy's religious capital. He had never intended to march this far from France. His supply situation was desperate, and he both expected and needed the Russians to daily sue for the peace which would allow him to return to France with honor before the onset of winter. He found Moscow strangely quiet as he awaited the return of his patrols. Once again, the Russians showed no sign of giving up the fight. Their fanatical national will to resist had led them to new levels of sacrifice. Now, in order to defeat the French, the entire population had abandoned Moscow, the holy city of Russia. So on the morning of September the 14th, the French army at last arrived at Moscow to find an eerie, deserted city forsaken by its whole population.
Le 14 septembre.
At 1 o'clock in the afternoon of September the 14th, after passing through a great forest, we saw a hill some way off, and half an hour afterwards, part of the army reached the highest point, signaling to us, who were behind, and shouting, "Moscow, Moscow." It was indeed the great city. There we should rest after all our labors, for we of the Imperial Guard had marched more than 1,200 leagues without resting. It was a beautiful summer's day. The sun was reflected on all the domes, spires, and gilded palaces. Many capitals I have seen, such as Paris, Berlin, Warsaw, Vienna, and Madrid, had only produced an ordinary impression on me. But this was quite different. The effect was to me, in fact to everyone, magical. While we were gazing at the city, the order was given to appear in full uniform. We had hardly entered the outskirts of the town when we met several of the miserable creatures expelled from the jail in the Kremlin. They had all horrible faces and were armed with muskets, staves, and pitchforks. We were astonished not to see anyone come out, not even a lady, to listen to our band playing "La victoire est à nous." We could not understand this total silence, and we imagined that the inhabitants, not daring to show themselves, were peeping at us from behind their shutters. Here and there we saw a few servants in livery and some Russian soldiers. The unkempt figure which Burgoyne had seen was one of the hundreds of criminals released by the city authorities in one of the greatest historic acts of civic self-denial. Their job was to set fire to the whole of the city in the face of a determined enemy in exchange for their liberty. The Russian arsonists did their job with great thoroughness, and soon two-thirds of the city was ablaze. The fire began an hour after our arrival. On our right, we saw a thick smoke, then a whirl of flames, not knowing from whence it came. We were told the fire was in the bazaar, the merchants' quarter. They're probably freebooters who have carelessly set fire to the shops in searching for provisions. But we met a number of chasseurs of the guard who told us that the Russians themselves had set fire to the town and that the convicts we had just seen did the business. Soon afterwards, we surprised three of these wretches setting fire to a Greek church. On seeing us, two of them threw away their torches and fled. We went up to the third, who kept his torch, and in spite of us tried to go on with his work. A stroke with the butt end of a musket on the head soon punished him for his obstinacy. Just then we met a patrol of fusilier chasseurs, who, like us, had lost their way. The sergeant in command told me that he had met convicts setting fire to a great many houses, that he had found one whose wrist he had to cut with his sword to force him to drop the torch, but that he had picked up the torch with his left hand to continue his piece of work, and they were obliged to kill him. When the rank and file of the French army realized that the town had actually been fired by the Russians themselves, all semblance of order disintegrated into a mass of looting and killing. The French were particularly harsh on any suspected arsonists, and justice was summary and brutal. Even after the horrors of Borodino, there were still a number of acts of brutality and barbarism to be played out in the deepening tragedy. About 10 o'clock, I saw a general on horseback riding up. He was leading a young man dressed in a sheepskin cape, fastened by a red woolen belt. The general asked me if I was in charge of the guard, and on my saying yes, he continued, "Very good. You will see that this man is put to death with the bayonet. I have just caught him with a torch, setting fire to the palace where I am staying." I told off four men, therefore, to carry out the general's orders. But French soldiers are not made for this kind of work, in cold blood. Our blows did not pierce through his sheepskin, and we should have spared his life on account of his youth. Moreover, he had not the appearance of a criminal, but that the general remained looking on till he saw the poor wretch fall from a shot in the side. We left him lying where he was. During the 16th, orders had been given to shoot everyone found setting fire to houses. This order was executed at once. On a little open space near the Place du Gouvernement, a number of incendiaries were shot and hung on the trees. While I was looking out of the window of our quarters at midday, I saw the shooting of another convict. He refused to kneel down, but met his death bravely, and, striking his breast, he seemed to defy his executioners. Besides the awful violence of the revenge extracted from the suspected arsonists among the civilian population, the French soldiers gave themselves over to plunder and robbery in the city, which they occupied for a whole month. Napoleon still waited in vain for Russian peace actions, while all the time the mild Russian autumn was slipping by and the bitter winds of winter approached. Unaware of their impending nemesis, the enemy soldiers continued their wanton life of pillage and excess. The destruction of the city, however, was not the disaster for Napoleon which has subsequently been painted. Fully a third of the buildings survived, more than enough to shelter all of his army. The real disaster for Napoleon was that in burning the city, the Russians had furnished final proof that they would not surrender, and that the war would therefore drag on to be fought in a hostile winter 1,500 miles from France. As this awful realization dawned upon Napoleon, it was all too obvious that his position was untenable. He could not hope to feed or reinforce his depleted ranks, and the only solution was to turn for home.
Now, he'd had one or two setbacks before. Early in 1799, he'd failed to capture the city of Acre in Syria. Then again, in 1809, he definitely was worsted at the Battle of Aspern-Essling, but then came back very strongly to win the Battle of Wagram and redeemed the situation. But in 1812, 500,000 casualties, all the political objectives of the campaign totally a failure. Prussia, one of his allies, negotiating an armistice, and indeed would join the forces of the Sixth Coalition a little later in early 1813. Napoleon was, if you like, a busted flush. Never again would he get the same response that he had had from his armies in earlier years. He was still going to achieve great things, but really you can say that from the end of 1812, it is not a question of will Napoleon be defeated, it is just going to be a question of how long can he drag on before he is completely defeated.
By mid-October, it was finally clear, even to the emperor, that all hope of a Russian peace overture had gone. So the bedraggled survivors of the Grande Armée finally came to leave Moscow, weighed down with plunder and bearing more resemblance to an army of itinerant merchants than soldiers.
Nous devions attendre la colonne. J'en profitais pour vérifier le contenu
As we were forced to wait for the column, I spent the time in making an examination of my knapsack, which seemed too heavy. I found several pounds of sugar, some rice, some biscuit, half a bottle of liqueur, a woman's Chinese silk dress, embroidered in gold and silver, several gold and silver ornaments, amongst them a little bit of the cross of Ivan the Great, at least a piece of the outer covering of silver gilt given me by a man in the company who had helped in taking it down. Besides these, I had my uniform, a woman's large riding cloak, then two silver pictures in relief, a foot long and 8 inches high, all in the finest workmanship. I had besides several lockets and a Russian prince's spittoon set with brilliants. These things were intended for presents and had been found in cellars where the houses were burnt down. No wonder the knapsack was so weighty. To lighten it, therefore, I left out my white trousers, feeling pretty certain I should not want them again just yet. I wore over my shirt a yellow silk waistcoat, wadded inside, which I had made myself out of a woman's skirt. Above that, a large cape lined with ermine and a large pouch hung at my side. Underneath the cape, by a silver cord.
parmi lesquels...
This was full of various things. Amongst them, a crucifix in gold and silver, and a little Chinese porcelain vase.
Ainsi que un petit vase en porcelaine de Chine.
These objects seem to have escaped the general ruin by a sort of miracle, and I still keep them as relics. Then there were my firearms and 16 cartridges in my cartridge case. Add to all this a fair amount of health, good spirits, and the hope of presenting my respects to the Mongol, Chinese, and Indian ladies I hope to meet, and you will have a very good idea of the Velit Sergeant of the Imperial Guard. These were the men who turned for home. 100,000 remnants from a force of 450,000. As they trudged off along the muddy roads, swiftly turning into quagmires in the early autumn rains, no one could have known just how few would survive to see France again. The time that Napoleon had spent vainly awaiting Russian peace overtures had effectively doomed his army. Had he left in September, there was still time to reach Poland before the onslaught of winter. As it now was, they would be marching into the jaws of a merciless winter. As often happens when misfortune compounds misfortune, when winter arrived, it was abnormally cold and early. Added to the extremes of cold were the never-ending attentions of the Russian army and the irregular Cossacks who harried the columns and killed French stragglers in their unremitting attacks. On one occasion, even the emperor himself was under threat.
The 25th? J'étais de garde depuis la veille près d'une maisonnette où l'empereur avait passé la nuit.
On the 25th, I'd been on guard since the previous evening near a little house where the emperor had spent the night. There was a thick fog, as there often is in October. All at once, without informing anyone, the emperor mounted his horse, merely followed by some orderly officers. He had scarcely gone when we heard a great noise. Just at first, we supposed it to be the cries of Vive l'Empereur, but then we heard the order, Aux armes, to arms. 6,000 Cossacks, commanded by Platov, had come to surprise us, favored by the fog and the deep ravines. The squadrons of the guard on duty flew across the plain. We followed them, crossing a ravine to make a shortcut. We found ourselves directly in front of this host of savages who howled like wolves as they drew back. Our squadrons came up with them, recaptured what they had taken of our baggage and wagons, and inflicted heavy losses on them. When we got to the plain, we saw that the emperor was in the midst of the Cossacks, surrounded by generals and by his orderly officers, one of whom was dangerously wounded through a fatal mistake. Just as the squadrons arrived on the plain, many of the officers, for their own defense and that of the emperor, who had nearly been taken in the midst of them, had been obliged to use their swords against the Cossacks. One of the orderly officers dropped his hat and his sword after killing and wounding several of the Cossacks. So, finding himself defenseless, he threw himself on a Cossack and took his lance from him. Just at that moment, a mounted grenadier of the guard caught sight of him and, thinking from his green cloak and his lance that he was a Cossack, rushed at him and ran him through the body. The unhappy grenadier, on seeing his mistake, endeavored to get killed. He flung himself amongst the enemy, striking to right and left, but everyone fled before him. After killing several men without being able to die, he returned alone and covered with blood to ask after the officer he had wounded. Fortunately, he recovered and was taken back to France in a sledge. I remember that, just after this incident, the emperor was talking to Murat, laughing at the narrow escape he had had of being taken. Montfort, the grenadier Velite from Valenciennes, again distinguished himself, killing and wounding many Cossacks. We waited for some time longer in this place and then resumed our march, leaving Kalonga on the left. We crossed a muddy river by a very bad bridge and took the direction of Jojaisk. It began to freeze during the night. On the 28th, we started very early, and during the day, after passing over a little river, we arrived at the famous battlefield of Borodino, covered all over with the dead, and with debris of all kinds. Legs, arms, and heads lay on the ground. Most of the bodies were Russians, as ours had been buried as far as possible. But as everything had been very hastily done, the heavy rain had uncovered many of them. It was a sad spectacle, the dead bodies hardly retaining a human resemblance. The battle had been fought 52 days before. As the army slowly made its way eastwards, the awful condition of the Russian roads began to take its toll on men and transport. Already the signs were ominous.
It is terrifying to realize how few people came back out of Russia from the Central Army Group. It went in, remember, in June, something like 460,000 strong. It was still 100,000 strong when they reached Moscow, but it is estimated that only 25,000 survivors of a Central Army Group came out of Russia into Poland. In addition, of course, there were the flanking forces, those of MacDonald in the north, which less the Prussians came out in fairly good order, and General Schwarzenberg's Austrians to the south, which came back almost intact, which makes a total of something like 75,000 out of 640,000 men at the end of that campaign who are still on their feet.
It was to prove fortunate indeed for Sergeant Burgoyne that he had found a bearskin to protect him. By November the 6th, the first snows of the terrible Russian winter fell upon the army, who were totally unequipped with any form of winter clothing.
Le 6 novembre, le brouillard était dense. Le thermomètre indiquait 22 degrés.
There was a dense fog that day, November the 6th, and more than 22 degrees of frost. Our lips were frozen, our brains too. The whole atmosphere was icy. There was a fearful wind, and the snow fell in enormous flakes. We lost sight not only of the sky, but of the men in front of us.
On ne pouvait plus distinguer ni le ciel, ni les hommes devant nous. Nous étions tous serrés les uns contre les autres.
We were just then packed very closely together near a wood, and had a long time to wait before we could resume our march, as the road was narrow.
Avant de reprendre notre marche, en raison de l'étroitesse de la route. Durant la demi-heure qui suivit,
during this half hour, several men had laid down and died. Many more had fallen in the column while marching. Our ranks were getting thinned already, and this was only the very beginning of our troubles. Whenever we stopped to eat hastily, the horses still left behind were bled. The blood was caught in a saucepan, cooked and eaten. But often we were forced to eat it before there was time to cook it.
Soit l'ordre de départ était donné.
Either the order for departure was given, or the Russians were upon us. In the latter case, we did not take much notice. I have sometimes seen men eating calmly, while others fired at the Russians to keep them obliged to go on. The saucepan was carried with us, and each man, as we marched, dipped his hands in and took what he wanted. His face, in consequence, became smeared with blood.
Et se servait. Le sang maculait leur visage. Souvent, nous étions obligés d'abandonner les
Very often we were obliged to leave the horses for want of time to cut them up, and men would drop behind and hide themselves for fear of being forced to follow their regiments. Then they would throw themselves on the meat like vultures. These men seldom reappeared. They were either taken by the enemy or they died of cold. Day after day, the march dragged on through a deepening winter. With the hard-pressed French constantly under attack by Cossacks and the main Russian army never far away, ready to pounce. Sergeant Burgoyne remembered the full horror of the retreat. We left behind us an enormous number of dead and dying. Further on, it was worse still, as we had to stride over the dead bodies left on the road by the regiments going before us. It was worst of all for the rear guard, as these were witnesses of all the horrors left by the whole army. We were now obliged to start very early in the morning and walk till very late. The days were so short it was not light till 8 o'clock, and it was dark by 4 in the afternoon. This was the reason of so many unfortunate men losing their way, for it was always night when we arrived at the bivouac, and all the remains of the different corps were weak, worn-out voices of new arrivals calling out, Fourth Corps, First Corps, Third Corps, Imperial Guard. Many, after walking the whole day, were forced to wander about half the night to find their particular corps. They hardly ever succeeded. Then, not being aware of the hour of departure in the morning, they slept too late, and on waking found the Russians upon them. Thousands of men were taken prisoners and perished in this way. Soon the road was completely blockaded by dead men and horses, sometimes preventing me from dragging myself along, for I had no longer the strength to lift my feet from the ground. Whenever I fell, it seemed as if I were dragged down by the unfortunate men stretched on the snow. Often these men would try to catch hold of the legs of those who passed, imploring their help, and many, in stooping to give help, fell themselves, not to rise again. Close to me, I found a small hatchet, such as every company carries in a campaign. I tried to cut off a piece off one of the horses, but the flesh was frozen so hard that this was impossible. I had spent the remainder of my strength, and I fell exhausted. But the exertion had warmed me a little. I had picked up with the hatchet a few pieces of ice, which I now found to be blood from the horse. I ate a little of it and put the rest carefully in my knapsack. And feeling stronger, I set out again, trusting to God's mercy, taking care to avoid the dead bodies. I went on, stopping and feeling my way whenever a cloud passed over the moon. Despite these appalling privations, the French army somehow managed to preserve some element of military cohesion. Marshal Ney, the bravest of the brave, led a dogged fight by a dwindling rearguard of survivors, and even in their reduced state, the exhausted army, reinforced by some relatively fresh troops who had not marched all the way to Moscow, was still, by superhuman effort, able to turn and fight off the Russians in the Battle of Krasno. However, as was always the case with Russia, it was to be a combination of natural obstacles and the embittered Russian population which was to finally break the French spirit. The River Bretsina presented just one of a series of natural barriers which the great Russian rivers present to an enemy marching from the west. As the French strength in Russia dwindled, they were unable to hold on to the bridges across the Bretsina, and the shattered remains of the army, now a pushing, shoving mob of humanity, had to attempt a crossing on hastily constructed pontoon bridges under fierce fire from an attacking Russian force. Napoleon had once before supervised the building of pontoon bridges for his army, but now the circumstances were desperately different.
Nous apercevions de courageux pontonniers travaillant dur afin que nous puissions traverser le pont.
We saw the brave pontonniers working hard at the bridges for us to cross. They had worked all night, standing up to their shoulders in ice-cold water, encouraged by their general. These brave men sacrificed their lives to save the army. One of my friends told me, as a fact, that he had seen the emperor himself handing wine to them. However, what had initially been a relatively orderly crossing soon degenerated into a rout, as the arrival of fresh Russian forces spread panic among the mass of stragglers and fugitives awaiting to cross the river with the remains of the army. Although countless thousands had died so far, and disorganized though it was, the Grande Armée was still a very large number of men. As thousands clamored to cross the bridges over the icy rivers, many stragglers were pushed into the river to die instantly in the freezing waters. As panic spread, one of the two bridges collapsed, and a scene of the utmost horror unfolded, while the living trampled the dead into the lethal waters and trapped men screamed for mercy as they froze to death. To the ever-present dangers of death at the hands of the Russian army, the irregular Cossacks, and the cruel ravages of a pitiless winter, was now added the vengeance of the Russian peasants. These poor people had suffered dreadfully at the hands of the French during their advance on Moscow, and now exacted a vicious revenge. Groups of stragglers and solitary soldiers were attacked and murdered in the most brutal fashion. The men, often too weak to defend themselves, gave in to a harsh fate, too far gone with exhaustion to even offer a semblance of resistance. As the struggling mob of fugitives finally dragged itself away from the banks of the Bretsina towards France and the promise of safety, it was now finally obvious that as a fighting force, the Grande Armée had effectively been annihilated. By December, there were apparently only 13,000 troops still around the colors. The remainder were a mass of dying stragglers spread out in a pathetic trail, stretching for miles behind the army. Napoleon at last decided that there was little point in remaining with the crumbling remnants. He ordered the eagles of the various corps to be burned, and he took his leave of them on December the 6th. Traveling under an assumed name, he fled to Paris. For him, the ill-fated Russian adventure was finally over. For many of the men, still 800 miles from home, it was just beginning.